Hey everybody, welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. So on today's episode, we're going to be taking a quick tour of my brand new workbench. In fact, this is the workbench that I have been thinking about and talking about for years and years and years, and I finally got around to actually building it. It was time to get in here and do something with it so that I could start enjoying more of the woodworking that I want to do versus kind of making things work with my old workbench. So if you remember the old workbench, it was big and bulky, and in fact, we actually did a video putting on a new surface for it, and for years, it worked great. In fact, if I was primarily using power tools, it would definitely be the optimal size for what I typically would do. But the fact is, I use a mix of hand tools and power tools, and unfortunately, that old bench just didn't work as well as it could for the hand tools. In fact, actually, I think it hindered me more than anything else, especially given the fact that right in the center was this nice deep bow that whenever you put a nice flat piece on here and you were trying to plane it, well, you hit the ends, but you never quite got in the middle. And of course, you can see how frustrating that would be. And given that it was plywood, there was no way to resurface it. It was just taking it off and throwing another sheet on. I could have spent the time shimming it up, but I didn't want to. I want this workbench. So if you're looking for a workbench build video, this is not the one. This is simply a tour. We'll talk about some of the details that went into the construction, but really, this is me just kind of showing off my newest addition. So probably the most common question I'm anticipating to get about the workbench is, what is it built from? And I actually chose to go with two materials, this 10-quarter poplar and then this 8-quarter maple. So the poplar was used for the top and the base, and then the legs and the vise were actually made from the maple. Why did I choose to go with this mix? Well, again, we've been talking about doing this bench for years, so I've kind of built up these materials in anticipation of it. Because every year I was going to build it, and then I didn't get around to it. So originally, I had enough of this 10-quarter poplar to build absolutely everything on here. Eventually, when I got around to it, I had enough to build the top, and that was about it. In fact, actually, the base is made from just some home center poplar that I ended up picking up and had laying around also, so I wanted to use materials that were already here in the shop. The legs and the vise, again, using the hard maple, that was originally material sent from the folks at Bell Forest a few years ago. And the whole purpose there was that I was going to build the entire workbench from hard maple. But again, over the years, I used that material for other things, so this is what I had laying around. If I had enough material to use either one, would I make it all out of poplar or would I make it all out of hard maple? Yeah, absolutely. Which one would I go with? I don't know. It just kind of depends because, to be honest with you, I really like the poplar for the top and the base. The combination of the two weight-wise, we'll talk a little bit about that, works out fantastic. But when it comes to the poplar, because it's a little bit on the soft end, or maybe it's a lot on the soft end of the hardwood scale, it makes it easier to work with. So I already have a couple of dents in here, again, because it's a softer hardwood. I'm not worried about them. It's not a showpiece, it's a workbench, but because it's a little bit softer, it's easy for me to clean these things up. And don't confuse that softness with meaning that this thing is going to start flexing and bowing, because it's not. Again, this was 10-quarter material, and we took it down to about, it's about 2.25 inches thick right here on the top. So this thing is not bowing. I can sit in the middle of this, I can push down really hard, and it's not going to bow. So that was the most important thing that I wanted in here. And again, being able to clean it up is really, really simple, so that's another nice thing. So when it comes to the dimensions of the workbench, there is some differences and some similarities. The similarity being that both workbenches were 5 feet in length, which is the perfect size, as far as I'm concerned, for my particular workshop. Given the average size of the components that I'm working with, this workbench can easily support them and allow me to do whatever work I need to do on them. If they need to be longer, I can add some roller stands or something to help me out. But on average, this size works great, and it doesn't take up a lot of space, which I'm kind of limited on here in the basement workshop. The dimensions that are definitely a difference are the depth and then the height. So the depth on the new workbench is coming in at 20 inches, and the old workbench is 27 inches. Doesn't sound like a lot, but it actually is. So number one, again, it's not taking up a lot of floor space. I can push it up against the wall and easily move through here without any issues. More importantly, when it comes to working on the workbench, or on the top here, is say I'm working with a wide panel and I want to plane it flat or smooth it or just do some sort of work on one side and on the other. With this 20-inch size, I can clamp it here, and I know if I pull the workbench away from the wall, I can work on the other side without really having to adjust the material back and forth. With that larger worktop, that's exactly what I'd have to do, is I would start here, and then I'd have to loosen it, move it over there, and then reclamp it, all that good stuff. So having this narrower worktop is going to work out great for me when it comes to working on some of my projects. Now, the most important thing is when it comes to the height of the workbench. With the older one, it was about 33 and a half, almost 34 inches. This one is coming in approximately 30 inches. So again, it's not a lot of dimension in there, but it's significant enough to help me with what I'm going to be doing. And the main thing is I was thinking of my hand planes again, because with the old workbench top, I kind of felt like I was holding them here. I had to kind of hold them here, and then I'd push, and I wasn't getting good pressure over the center of them to make sure I was getting the best results. With this one, when I'm grabbing those hand tools coming down here, you can see that I'm already here. So if I'm holding them, I can really get my weight over the top of them, push it through, and get the results that I want without feeling fatigued and really being able to do it the way that I've learned to do it. Now, the idea of that dimension is completely customized, and it came from Christopher Shore's workbench book. And in fact, the way I determined the 30 inch is I stood nice and straight, I had my hands down on my side, and I had my wife Samantha come down here and help me measure. And what we were looking for was the height from the floor to the top knuckle of my pinky, and we're going to use that as an approximate size. So that is where the top of the workbench comes up off the floor. And again, I'm really looking forward to getting those great results from my hand tools. So let's take a second to talk about the workbench top. As you can see by the end grains here, these are three boards lined up right next to each other and glued up to make this nice 20-inch wide top. Why did I choose to go with this versus, say, ripping these and then setting them side by side, as you often see with workbenches? Because it's 10-quarter material, I know for a fact that this poplar is rigid enough to keep from bowing in the center here. I figured, why make it difficult on myself and do that and go through all those extra glue-up steps when I could simply do this and get the same exact result that I want? So I chose it for simplicity and ease of use. To get the boards jointed and thickness planed, I just did it with my thickness planer sled because these were some big boards and it just made it that much easier. Once I had everything together, I came in with my jointer plane and planed the surface. And in fact, actually going through with a straight edge, I noticed I got a couple of spots I need to concentrate on, but probably 98% of it is exactly where I want it to be, so I'm not too worried about it. The next thing I wanted to do was put in a series of matching bench dog holes on either side again, so depending on how I want to clamp it, you know, we can just kind of go from there. And I have them 6 inches on center. Why that size? I don't know. It just seemed to be like a nice number, so that's what I ended up going with. And the way I did this is once I had the top all glued up and planed and all that good stuff, I broke out my drill press, and as you can see in this footage, I just simply moved it along and drilled my holes so that they were nice and straight. At some point, I probably will be adding more bench dog holes in here, and in that case, I'm not going to be using the drill press. I'll just use my hand drill and carefully line it up so that they go in nice and square. So as for the legs, again, we just did our basic milling, laminated them together, and created our 3.5-inch by 3.5-inch leg. And the way that we've attached the top to the legs is we created a tenon on the legs first at the table saw, and then we came in using that tenon as a guide. We want to make sure that the legs were flush with the front here, so once we had it in position, we marked where that matching mortise was supposed to be, drilled most of it out with a Forstner bit, and then cleaned it up with our chisels until we got a nice snug fit. Once I had all four of those in place, it was all good. I was thinking, and I may end up coming back doing this eventually, driving some dowels through here that go through the top into that tenon and then onto the other side. If necessary, I can do this to help make sure that these aren't going anywhere, but they're snug right now. And because this is the dry season, as I made this, once we go into the warmer summer months, when things start to expand a little bit, I know they're going to get nice and tight. So if we need to address it again next year, we'll do it. But as of right now, these are going nowhere. In fact, it would be very, very difficult to get the workbench top off of the legs, because once we attached this apron, it pulled everything really super snug. And in fact, actually, I know some of you weren't too thrilled with this, but we used pocket hole screws to pull this all together. It works fantastic. The last thing I added was this shelf right here. Again, that's going to really help to add rigidity to the overall bench, so it's not going to move on me. And then one more thing we need to do is to talk about the vices, because we have a front leg vise, and then I have this end vise, which actually acts kind of like a wagon vise. I knew that I was going to have a leg vise on the front of my workbench, so what I ended up doing was getting some of my maple that I had, and I found a board that actually had a bit of a bow in it along the length. And this worked out perfect, because once I flattened the front side of it, I left that bow in there. So when I tighten this, it's actually a little bit tighter here at the top and there at the bottom, so it helps to hold it in place nice and snug. The hardware I used is the same hardware I had on my previous one, and it's actually a tail vise screw that I picked up from Lee Valley. I'll have a link in the show notes for it, but I also have a link for something similar that you can get on Amazon.com that works easily well. So this works together, comes together really nicely. Another thing I did here at the bottom, originally the last one I had, I just simply had a guide at the bottom, and I would often have to kind of shim something in here to help make sure that it didn't kind of rack when I was tightening it. I took the time to kind of square off the rod and put in some holes for the average size materials I'm working with, and I just dropped a Allen wrench into it to help hold it in place, so when I snug this up against the edge, it's going to stop from racking. So that's a really nice feature that I decided to add to this one. Now at the opposite end here, I have this impromptu kind of wagon vise, which is going to help me to pinch my material in here for when I am flattening it or working on the edge or whatever. It's just going to help to make sure that it's not going anywhere. And all I used was just a simple vise that I actually had attached on my old bench. And in fact, this is one of the first vices I ever had on any of my workbenches. All I did was add this nice big thick piece of maple in here so that I could attach this bench dog, and it works great. I could still actually use it to clamp something in here on the end, but more than likely I'm just going to use it for this wagon vise type feature. And that's all there is to the brand new workbench. Again, it's so much smaller than the other one in a couple of key dimensions, but the one thing I found that's really interesting is the fact that it's actually heavier than the previous one, and I've already had some opportunity to do some planing on this, and rather than chasing the workbench, it's actually staying in place more than it ever has. So I'm really looking forward to doing more work on this, and the fact that it looks so much prettier than what I had. Not that that's an important feature, but it's kind of nice to look at. It's nice to have a little eye candy down in the workshop other than me. So if you have some comments, questions, suggestions, I'd love to hear from all of you. You can email me at mattsbasementworkshop@gmail.com. Of course, you can leave a comment in the show notes for today's episode at mattsbasementworkshop.com. Or if you're watching this on YouTube, you can leave a comment over there. I love hearing from all of you. So until the next time, straight grains and sharp blades. Take care, everybody.
Thanks for watching. For more information on topics discussed in this episode, visit mattsbasementworkshop.com.